So I'm going to go ahead now and do a little numerical example with a utility function here. So I've got a utility function, and it's a pretty simple one. There are lots of ways in which economists model utility function. In this one, the person's utility is just their consumption raised to whatever number I've put in this cell here. So I'm calling this thing theta. That's the name of the coefficient. So when this person has zero consumption, they get 0 raised to the 0.4 power. When they have $1,000 of consumption, they get 1,000 raised to the 0.4 power, and so on and so forth. And just because this is ugly to have so many decimal places, let me go ahead and decrease the number of decimal places to make it a little bit less ugly. Okay, so you can see we also have the concept of what's called marginal utility. So another way of saying people are risk averse is that they have decreasing marginal utility. So the first $1,000 of consumption gets this person 15.84 units of utility. Let's go ahead, just highlight all of this. So the first $1,000 worth of income gets this person 15.8 units of utility. And don't worry too much about exactly what the units are. And the second 1,000 gets them 5.1. The third 1,000 gets them 3.7. So what I keep on doing here to calculate this is I take the new value and subtract off the previous value. And if we wanted to look at these things graphically, this curve right here is how their total utility changes as their income changes. This curve over here is how their marginal utility changes. Another way of saying that is the marginal utility is the slope of that curve there. So this is all good and nice and everything, and we can see how marginal utility gets smaller and smaller and smaller as we go up to higher and higher levels of consumption. Two things to illustrate. One is, I talked previously about we could think about what level of consumption would be equivalent to the risk that they're bearing. So if this person was at $5,000 worth of consumption and they faced a 50-50 chance of either being $5,000 poorer, which would get them zero consumption, or $5,000 richer, which would be 10,000 consumption, then what level of utility would they get? Well, we would think normally that they would have a 50% chance of having the low level of utility up here, and a 50% chance of having that high level of utility there. So this calculation takes each of those numbers in D4 and D14, multiplies by 0.5 because you have a 50% chance of ending up in each of those categories, and then figures out what level of utility that would give you. And it gives you 19.9. And you can see 19.9 is equivalent to being somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000. In particular, we can take that 19.9 and raise it to 1 over this theta and get back to the level of income that would be consistent. So this person would rather receive $1,767 with 100% certainty than face this gamble of, well, I could end up $5,000 better off, or I could end up $5,000 worse off and get nothing at all. So obviously they're quite anxious to avoid having nothing at all. Another way to look at this kind of thing is, how would people react to different bets here? And so what I'm thinking of now is a bet where heads, they win $150, tails, they lose $50. So obviously, on average, this is a winning bet. And in particular, you can see that, well, on average, they're going to go ahead and win about $50. So this particular person, if they face that bet, don't worry too much about the exact math here. This person would have higher utility if they have the opportunity to take this bet. And you can see that kind of relative to the level of income they already have, this prospect of like worst case scenario is I lose $50. Well, that's not too bad, and there's considerable upside. What if we go ahead and look at a case where it's the same expected gain? Notice the good scenario was $100 higher than the bad scenario. But the swing around is much bigger. Instead of negative 50 versus plus 150, we have negative 500 versus plus 600. And yes, this person still benefits from taking that bet on average, but not by as much. An even more uncertain bet, same expected outcome, the average winnings are still the same, but the level of uncertainty is much greater with bet number 3, and this person would reject that bet. Because essentially the downside pain of losing $1,000 is so big compared to the average expected gain of $50. And they're definitely going to reject number 4. So at a higher level of income, this person's attitudes towards those bets changes. The first two bets, they were acceptable before. Now the third bet is also acceptable for this person who has $15,000 worth of consumption. The fourth bet is still unacceptable to them. And then finally, if we go down to someone who has an even higher level of consumption, someone who was already at 35,000, they're going to find all of these bets as potentially rewarding for them. So notice someone's level of current income or current consumption is going to affect how risk averse they are. Also, just some people have a different psychology. It might be that this theta here, which is going to tell us something about their risk aversion, is just going to be different for different people. And the way I've written this, this theta essentially measures how risk tolerant someone is. If they have a theta of 1, they're completely risk tolerant. If they have a theta of like 0.01, then they're going to be pretty risk intolerant. So just people may have different psychological predispositions. Some people are sort of very anxious and risk avoidant. Other people are a little bit more optimistic and risk tolerant. And people are just going to end up making different decisions because of that, in addition to differences in their level of income.